Now, name the event in which Baron de Coubertin won his own Olympic medal. Who was Baron de Coubertin?
Was he the one who reinvented the Olympic Games?
Yeah, he's known as the father of the modern Olympic movement.
And so he obviously set up one event that he's the only person who did, so that he could win it.
To give him credit, he did it anonymously.
Ah. So that's why he's wearing a false moustache.
How many events can you enter anonymously?
Not too many, I suppose.
Exactly.
But, so it's got to be something when you're hidden. You're
you don't need to be seen.
It's a race between pantomime horses, and he was the back end of one of the winning horses.
It's not as absurd as it sounds. I mean, there were some really odd Olympic events at the beginning.
You're completely hidden?
Well...
Tunnelling.
You're
Olympic tunnelling.
You're thinking of physical things, aren't you?
Ah,
so but the Olympic Games was wider than that.
So, essay writing or poem composing?
Poem is the answer.
Ah.
He won the gold medal for poetry.
Shut up!
Oh, you think that's weird? All the way up to 1948, there was a gold medal for town planning in the Olympics.
Won by Milton Keynes.
Lost by Milton Keynes, you would imagine. But no, there were all kinds of artistic categories. There was sculpture, music, painting, literature.
Sculpture. And look at him go! The young Greek... the young Greek's mallet is flying!
The oldest ever medal winner was a silver medal winner, aged 73, in the 1948 engravings and etchings event.
That's fantastic.
He was a Briton called John Copley. In 1900, there was a woman who won possibly the oddest event, a farmer's wife. It was the poodle clipping event. She trimmed 17 poodles in 2 hours.
Yes.
Can you imagine? She got a gold medal for it.
I'm sure she did, 17 in 2 hours. That's impressive even to me.
Yeah, isn't it? But do you know the reason they stopped doing the sculpture and the painting and the poetry and everything else?
It was something to do with the...
Drugs.
Drugs and the sex test.
No, the reason they stopped was because they felt that it rather compromised the idea of amateurism, because it's basically all the artists and things would carry on being artists for the rest of the year, whereas the other Olympians, those who threw javelins, they held down other jobs.
The most dangerous football player of all time.
Stanley Life Matthews.
So, are we talking about offences committed on the field or in another life as an assassin? Or
no, I'm talking about actually
bombing?
On the football field.
Does it have something to do with the early, very early origins of football?
It does.
Yes.
In the 16th century, if somebody died accidentally during a football game, all of the players were put on trial for manslaughter, and in theory, the person who was responsible for the accident was liable to be hanged. Now, the courts were reluctant to do this, so the coroner would return a verdict of murder, but the name of the culprit was always John at Style. So it's a legal fiction. It's a bit like John Doe today. So on paper, John at Style is still the most dangerous footballer in history. There's a wonderful professor in Oxford called Stephen Gunn, and he studies... I like people to study very specific things. He studies accidental death in 16th century England. And we have established through his work that football was unbelievably dangerous. It caused more deaths than sword fighting in the 16th century. There were at least 7 deaths in England. I have to say, beaten only by 56 people who died in archery accidents. Of the 7 football deaths, 2 accidentally were stabbed with a knife while tackling. joint third, sword fighting, wrestling and bell ringing, 3 deaths each. Hammer throwing, 2 deaths. 1 person died in a game of quoits. I have no idea why. In one of the archery deaths, there was a man who accidentally shot himself in the head in 1552.
It's quite
tricky. He was called Henry Pert from Welbeck.
He's got the bow the wrong way round.
Well, he drew the bow to full extent, and the idea was to aim it straight up into the air. And the arrow lodged into the bow, and so he leant over to have a look. Yeah.
How did the bell ringers... they fall, is that...?
No, they go hide. Have you seen in The Sound
did they
of
go
Music?
Up the...
And they go... There's that one kid that's going up and down for the whole intermezzo, isn't there, in that?
Yeah, I didn't think that was a documentary, though. The bells fall on them, or do they go up and then fall?
No,
they went back up and then they fell.
See, I was right. No. Handgun accidents, so they don't start to overtake archery until the 1550s. The very first one was 1519 in Hull. So there was a Hull woman which was accidentally shot by a Frenchman, rather brilliantly called Peter Frenchman.
No, that's got to be a nickname, that.
She had never seen a gun before. She didn't know what it was.
Friday night in Hull.
She just walked in front of it while it was being fired.
Saying that, my dad walked in front of a dartboard and got a dart straight in the side of his head.
Did he not know what a dartboard was? I mean, she had an excuse. She'd never seen a gun before.
Yeah, no, he was shit-faced.
Which international head of state snubbed Jesse Owens after his triumph at the 1936 Olympics?
Well, go on.
Yes, go.
Hitler.
Oddly enough, it's not true. It's what the whole world thinks, but it isn't true. And we know this from no greater source than Jesse Owens himself. In fact, it's a really rather sad and a very typically, I'm afraid, unfortunate story. Jesse Owens, as you probably know, won 4 gold medals at the 1936 Berlin Olympics. The Olympics were stage managed, of course, by Hitler. Now, on the first day, Hitler congratulated only German winners. And someone said to him that he should either congratulate all the winners or none of them. So he said, well, in that case, I won't congratulate any winners. So as it happens, he didn't personally congratulate... He didn't personally congratulate Jesse Owens. Were you looking at that?
The bloke on the far right is just going like that.
That bloke on the far right
to be fair,
is called Hermann Göring.
I think surely they're all on the far right.
Yeah. Hey! Brilliant.
They're all just they're taking bets on how high the high jump was going to go.
The one on Hitler's left thinking, I didn't get the memo. I didn't know. This start.
How to dress. Well, no, it is rather extraordinary. As I say, Hitler decided on the second day that he wouldn't congratulate anyone. So he didn't snub Jesse Owens at all. In fact, according to Jesse Owens, he said, when I passed the Chancellor, he arose, waved his hand at me, and I waved back at him. Hitler didn't snub me. It was... Who snubbed him?
So Hitler wasn't such a bad guy after all.
No, it's not bad. It's not bad.
The jury's still out.
Hitler is, we know, is bad. It just so happened he didn't snub Jesse Owens.
King of England.
No, FDR.
Oh,
the
bastard.
The president of his own country. Now, this is a terrible story here. It was FDR who snubbed me. The president didn't even send me a telegram. He won 4 gold medals. When I came back to my native country, after all the stories about Hitler, I couldn't ride in the front of the bus. I had to go to the back door. I wasn't invited to shake hands with Hitler, but I certainly wasn't invited to the White House to shake hands with the president either. He had to use the goods lift of the Waldorf Astoria to get into the reception for returning US athletes, as he wasn't allowed to use the front door.
So Sammy Davis Jr. couldn't go in the front door of the hotels in Vegas where he was performing.
I know. It is simply astonishing.
He had to go in through the kitchen.
Yeah.
Yeah. It still happens to me, though, sometimes.
Eskimo Indian Olympics have been held every year since 1961. Phone books not involved, but these are more toys for you to play with. Voila. Voila. And I'm afraid you're going to have to prepare to get a little bit sticky. These lubed rods. Here, which are very icky.
trying to get me to do this for years.
Stop. Sorry, Stephen, but this contravenes my super injunction.
All you have to do is try and work out what the sports are in the World Eskimo Indian Olympics, as they're now officially called.
Well, that's obviously...
You can play it with Brian. It's actually... each one of these games is like most games, is there really basically to hone the skills you need for the environment in which you live.
Is this a two-person game?
It's a two-person game.
Is it fire?
No, fire leave the string for the moment and grab the stick and... it's all right. It's very
helpful. I think it is.
No, you have to do it with your hands. No. That's it.
Like that.
And it's the one who can basically, without twisting or jerking, the one who can get the stick off the other.
Oh, Christ, I've got no chance.
Sean won.
There you can see them doing it.
Go on, have a go. There you go.
Right, this time, this time you're going on the floor.
There you go.
No, you're holding my hand there, Brian.
Oh, sorry.
I've only got
no twisting or jerking.
I think you're on one side. You're on one side.
My hands are too big.
Here we go.
Can you go?
Oh, look, eagle.
No twisting or jerking.
And we have a spoon game yet to play, which is another game.
Right. Right.
Let me guess, we have to wrap it around our balls.
No, you don't. You do have to wrap it around an organ.
Oh, that's it.
Fortunately, not an organ of generation. An auditory organ, one of your ears. Each wraps it round the ear. You wrap the other end down your ear and you pull. Be brave.
Put it around your ear.
It's a pain endurance test.
I'll go around the other ear.
Oh, look, what happened to his ear? I don't want that to my ear.
As you can see from the photograph, it's an endurance and pain are really the... you've got glasses on, of course. I don't know if that helps. Is that an advantage or a disadvantage?
I think it's a disadvantage because they're very, very springy.
Yeah, whoa! I declare the winner there, Brian. Who's been winning on your side?
Yeah.
You've turned it into a plait.
I cheated. Look, I tied it.
You definitely cheating. These are official sports of the Eskimo Olympics. John, the painter Caravaggio was once arrested for throwing artichokes at a waiter. The art historian Andrew Graham Dixon discovered something about Caravaggio's outrageous behaviour on the tennis court. What was it?
Something's interesting about Caravaggio. He died in 1610, but that now you've brought me the advice now. I think it's 1610, and of course, and he committed murder. But in fact, Andrew's programme. But not that we should be talking about other programmes. That's far too incestuous.
Well, this is what the question is about. Is about Andrew Graham Dixon, the art historian, who made a programme about
Sorting
Caravaggio.
Sorting out why, in fact, Caravaggio died prematurely and was possibly murdered by those avenging him for the death of Tomasino. I think was the artist who he had the fight with. For those of you who didn't watch,
that's good.
Stay with us.
Yeah.
And
I'll give you 5 points there. But I'll, anybody else know the answer to this? What Caravaggio did on a tennis court?
On a tennis court. He said, enough with the square balls, why don't we use my round?
Well, these are all good answers. I'll have to tell you.
Was he beaten by a British player? That's what I still talk about.
Excellent. For almost 400 years, historians have believed that Caravaggio was exclusively homosexual, and they believed that he murdered a man called Ranuccio Tomassoni in a squabble over a tennis match. But it's now thought, thanks to the pioneering work of Andrew Graham Dixon, that Tomassoni's death was an accident and Caravaggio was only trying to cut off his testicles, not to kill him. There you are.
Yes. Over a game of tennis.
Well, yes.
New balls, please.
Minus 10 points.
Oh. I didn't even know who he is.
Caravaggio.
Thank God you said that.
To my mind, that's not interesting enough.
I was hanging in.
Oh, no, Caravaggio is very interesting. You would find him. He was the really, perhaps,
I know
the greatest
about
17th
century castration, though. I knew that's what it was.
Tell me about
and
castration.
And it's to do with this.
Yes.
When they castrate a sheep, they do it without breaking the skin of the scrotum.
Yes.
Yes.
And the testicles just fall into the ball sack, and then they do the kind of grape sultana thing. They become
they
little
drop off. They wither,
shrivelly.
Don't they?
They do wither. Yeah. Mm.
Use a little elastic band. Don't you
use a little tiny elastic. I've got one on at the moment.
That's interesting.
To Prince Albert.
Prince Albert, now there's a story.
Oh, really?
Yes, yes.
He and Victoria, they had masses of sex. I mean, they had 9 children, and they probably had sex maybe 100 times a night for years and years and years. Until he died. Stopped after he died. But,
is that why the Albert Memorial is a great big tall...
Precisely.
I did a charity show in the heyday of the Spice Girls, and there was a lineup afterwards with the Prince of Wales.
I was there.
Were you there? You were that one. Do you remember? And they asked him whether or not Prince Albert actually did wear a Prince Albert.
No, and he
and
said...
Prince Will said, I have no idea what a Prince Albert is. I had to explain to him that it wasn't an item.
Did you tell him?
I didn't say it was a cock ring. I said.
Did you use
it? I said it was a piece of jewellery worn in an intimate area.
Oh, I see. He would have said.
He said, oh, a cock ring!
What did Thomas White invent in 1771?
The Yorker.
The Yorker?
Yeah.
To hear a German say the Yorker gives
I don't know what it means.
It's a fully pitched up ball, but it's a real good, great to hear
what's
a German.
What's googly then?
Yeah. Googly is a.
Again.
A googly is a leg spinner's off spin. It's disguised. It's
comes out the back. And how does the duck versus Lewis method work?
Oh, nobody knows that. That's far too complicated. No, he didn't invent any particular type of bowling or of batting, but he looked at the laws of cricket and he noted that there was a rather glaring omission, and he thought he could. He thought splendid.
Oh, the big bat. Did he have
yes,
a big bat?
Yes, he came with a bat that was wider than the wicket. This enormous bat. It was Chertsey versus Hambledon, which is the equivalent of Surrey versus Hampshire. So after 1774, they incorporated a law that said a bat must be no wider than 4.5 inches. But this fellow, Thomas White, I suppose you could call him a cheat, but he was within the laws of the game as they were at the time. And there were others. There's an American footballer called Lester Hayes. Does that ring any bells with you? Of the Oakland Raiders, who had such success as a catcher in the late 70s that he was the defensive player of the year. But the reason was that he covered his hands and gloves with an adhesive called Stick'em. And he actually admitted, he said, without Stick'em, I couldn't catch a cold in Antarctica.
That's so clearly cheating. They must have spotted
well,
that.
Well, there was no rule against it. They had to introduce one, which there now is. There was a jockey at Belmont in New York who, in 1923, died of a heart attack when on a horse and won. That the horse won.
Oh, right.
And, of course, the bookies didn't want to pay out. But there was a rule that said the jockey had to be in the saddle. There was no rule that said he had to be alive.
Well, he was a brilliant jockey, then, if he clung on even though he was dead.
Exactly. I mean, that's pretty amazing. So,
keep going!
So the lucky punters... If Johnny and Jason got naked, covered their legs... I know.
I mean, I can't. I can't.
We're still sure to open wedding gifts together.
He's still the beating hearts of the nation. If they got naked, covered their legs in lard, and put their hands on each other's shoulders, what could we expect to happen next?
I would guess Ofcom would get involved.
Something com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd obviously be the.
The
female
bit.
In the relationship. I'm the one who needs rescuing.
Yeah.
And why are legs in lard? Are they going to slither about?
Legs are important in this particular pursuit.
It's a red wine that we are about to trample the grapes for that you can also fry with. It's the first kind of sippy lard.
Yes, that's right.
So you can have a glass and do your chips in it also.
Available in every Yates's wine lodge.
Yeah.
Maybe a rush like a Christmas when Jamie Oliver said to use goose fat, except this time they'd be using comedians kind of dripping. You know what? These potatoes taste a bit funny.
Twice fried Johnny dripping. No, we're in North, and we're right. It's a pursuit. It's a pursuit in the northwest.
It's not shin kicking.
Yes, it is shin kicking.
Ah.
You knew about shin kicking.
I did. My uncle was one.
Yay! Very good. There you are. And I don't know if he left. Did he bequeath you his pair of clogs?
He was. You know what? By the time I knew him, he was blind and spoke at like pretty much nonsense in the corner. But he was a phenomenal shin kicker. He was a very tough man, and that was his pastime, was shin kicking.
Is that a blade?
Yes, it is.
Take it in turns.
Oh, yeah.
To kick each other in the shin as hard as you can. And it's the first person to basically...
Do you know what they cry if they give up? It's rather wonderful. You'd think it'd be, I give in, or, oh, stop it.
Stop
no.
It.
Go on with your brother.
Yeah.
No.
It's
not that. It's not that. They shout, sufficient. That's the cry.
oddly enough, that's my climax call. We're not greedy in our nature up north.
I have to confess, I've never heard the phrase climax call before. So it took a bit of time for me to understand what you were saying. Forgive me.
I think it's actually from bird watching.
They rip the skin off each other's legs and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
I mean,
God.
One of the reasons for larding the shins was in order to encourage a glancing blow rather than a really vicious one. But the skill was obviously to move your legs so that it was a glancing blow.
The more I get to know you, the more I think men are mad. Always up to something ridiculous. Kicking each other in the lardy shins, you're like...
Shin kicking is probably what it was called on an everyday basis, but in the 19th century there was a special word for it, which was purring or purrin. Purrin or pourin or parin. They seem to be all used. Parin, purrin. Parring maybe because you were parrying away. Nobody quite knows. But anyway, it was a popular pastime.
How upset are the Germans about the 1966 World Cup?
Well, very, I would say. Well, they would be, if they surely, I would have thought, a proud nation like the Germans.
They were upset at the time, but I said, how upset are they? They barely remember it. If you asked every German who won the World Cup in 1966...
Yeah, they're pretending.
No, because the fact is...
The World Cup? No, I don't know.
No, because we care about it, they don't. They care about their scores against Holland. That's their big thing. They really, honestly, if you ask the average German, they're just... 66. They really don't know. Oh, did you? Well done. You know,
international.
For us, it was like everything. Wow, we won. But they, in 1974, beat the Dutch, and that to them was the one they really, really care about.
But they surely, the Dutch have never provided great deal of opposition to them. Generally, in history, they've just walked into Holland whenever they fancied it.
Oh, in that sense.
Well, any time they want, they just go into Holland, which is just like spin the windmill. I haven't mentioned it yet. I was talking about the great Geschmertz flip in 1762, where they just walked into Holland, but they can just enter. I'll mention the war. You have to. Surely they're denying their true rivalry, which will be with us.
They're
in denial.
We may think that, but it's up to them to decide. I mean, you can't force a German to care about whether they beat us or not.
Well, they bloody well should.
Yes. I'm sure you're very upset by it, but, I mean, they just don't care that much. And there are other things like the sun lounge hogging with the towel.
Yeah.
Is that something you've actually experienced?
Yeah.
There's some picture.
These are some of Alan's holiday photos.
It turns out that a German lawyer called Ralph Hooker actually did a study, and he confirms that we think it. But Germans are blissfully unaware of their reputation in this case.
No,
but
really?
A study by Halifax...
Well, I think they don't care is the right description of it.
They just don't... They don't know that's what we think of them.
They
but
think
Halifax
it's
travel
just common sense to go down before breakfast, basically at dawn.
It turns out...
take all the beds around the pool.
That Halifax Travel Insurance in 2009 confirmed with a study that Germans are the most likely to reserve sun lounges with towels. And which nation do you think is the second most likely to?
The Dutch.
The British.
The British.
Yeah. Very close.
We'll turn up 10 minutes later.
Exactly. While the French and Italians and Portuguese are having breakfast and not really caring.
And also they're in their own countries.
That's... that's true.
Enjoying the lovely food and the weather.
What is cannon hopping? Cannon is, I think, maybe related to the English word coney. Does that help?
Rabbit, like a...
Rabbit.
Okay.
So rabbit hopping.
So hopping like a bunny. Bunny hopping.
Hopping like a bunny, but it's a sport. Rabbit.
Oh, for sure it is.
Show jumping.
Show jumping for rabbits is the right answer.
Sure.
It's not that big a sport in Britain, but in Denmark and the Scandinavian countries, they take it pretty seriously, and they have world records, and they have championships, and...
Who's winning? Who's the current world champion?
Well, I can tell you the world record holder for the long jump is Yabu, who's Danish, 3 metres.
With Flopsia, close second.
Thorsten has the high jump record at 99.5 centimetres. They haven't yet broken the metre on the high jump. But there are nearly 1,000 rabbit show jumpers in Sweden alone, and the sport is also practised in the UK, Denmark and the US. And Lisbeth Janssen has written two books about the sport.
Mm. Do they dope test them afterwards?
She does say that the sport will allow a rabbit to live twice as long, up to 10 or 12 years, as compared to the average 5 years that one in a hutch will live.
Yeah. So it's very important to take care of your and rabbit properly as well. You've got to bathe them in hot water with potatoes and onions.
Oh, no! Let's have some footage of some working...
Oh, large footage.
Here they go.
Sure, OK.
Oh, cute! Oh, cute! Oh, I can't bear it.
That's a big one. Oh! Oh, he's going to refuse. No, he's up. Oh!
Just shut it.
Over he goes.
Oh, he's had
a... And a final little one. Bravo! Name all the events at the first recorded Olympic Games in the year 776 BC.
Discus.
Oh, my God, go.
Javelin.
No. No, try harder.
Hammer.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. No, no, I think that way madness lies.
Well, running.
Yes, but running is the answer.
Running, there's running.
Just one race.
Just one race.
And if you get the distance, I will be astonished.
200 metres.
That's damn close. It's unfair. It's very unfair. I think you've taken enough forfeits because there was just one event and it was 192 metres. which is the modern equivalent. It's a stadium, which is the length of the stadium. And that was the only race in the first Olympic Games.
That was
Games.
The Olympic Games.
The first recorded one.
Yeah.
But they later developed, and indeed included discus and javelin and all wrestling and boxing and all the things you've mentioned. But unfortunately, the first recorded one was just one.
When was the first recorded one?
776 BC. Now, the next question, which is a subsidiary to this first recorded Olympics, is what was the naked chef doing there?
Ding dong.
Yes. Is that a response to the buttocks or...?
Yeah, the yeah. prime pair.
For war.
Naked cooking for the athletes.
No, not quite.
Preparing meals for the judges. Really? Selling food to the audience. Won the race.
Yes, quite right. The winner was a cook. His name was Coroebus of Elis, and he was a cook, and like all the contestants, was naked.
They all ran in the nude.
All ran in the nude. In the
How
nudie.
Wonderful.
Even the trainers.
I would like to have seen the triple jump.
What about the pole vault?
Oh, dear.
He Coroebus, of course, won by a short head. No. After his final spurt. No, shut up. What's the best way to charm a worm? There's a worm.
Charm.
How would you charm a
tap, worm? Tap. Oh. Tap. Tap the surface. Yeah, because when it rains, they come up. Yeah. So birds do that, where they jump up and down and they make a noise like rain and then they come up.
Is it yes. Work? Actually, what they think is that there's a mole nearby. And the earthworm's way of escaping from mole is to come to the surface because obviously the moles don't come up. So there are...
Are they not friends? I imagine they'll be friends.
No, moly and wormy are not friends.
Wormy. I'm going to stop you there because in my mind they're quite good friends. Oh. And then if on the ground they have a terrific little time.
You'd think...
Hello.
Could you charm a worm with a tiny flute?
Well, it's good you should say this because worm charming is a big, I won't say industry exactly, but it's a big pastime both in America and in this country. There's the commercial side of it because.
Oh, look, there they are. Oh, for God's sake.
I know. I know you've got your get a life look on. And I do know what you mean, but.
I really have.
There's nothing that discernible, is there? You know, when you go, hi, you've got lovely.
What, I mean, charming no them in that sense. They've got a little saddle in the middle. That can be attractive.
Yeah, but that's that myth, isn't it? That's where they've been cut in half.
Oh, I see, and regrown, and could, yes, yeah. yes, yes.
Something
yes.
happened
you
between...
Them, you can chop them in half. You can do it with any animal.
Yeah, but they don't join back... they don't join back
No, they can't. It's a myth that they can. But in America, they call it grunting, this worm charming, and it's reasonably big business because Americans love to fish, and yep. obviously bait shops need worms as well as maggots.
That girl in the foreground is tapping the ground with a flip-flop.
She is.
She's got flip-flops on. She's taken extra flip-flops.
Well, she's only done it to annoy you.
It just looks like a car boot sale where everyone's forgot the cars.
Photoshopped out of the picture.
It does rather, doesn't it? What it is in Britain, the sport, if I can call it that, involves dozens of competitors. Oh, my God.
She's got a worm on her shirt.
Oh, bless her.
I don't know if that's a worm. I don't think we should look at that.
Oh, dear. You have to lure as many worms as you can in 30 minutes.
With a recorder?
Well, with anything you choose. You can just tap the
And why the time constraint? Is that because it's just you're out on day release?
Well... Possibly the low point was in Woodhall. The Woodhall Worm Charming Festival in Lincolnshire. None of the entrants in August 2010 managed to lure a single worm.
This is the Worm Charming Festival, isn't it?
Those people inside at the time, were they in a building? Is no. That right?
Yeah, it was raining, we had to do it in the church hall.
Try and explain it.
I'm getting nothing.
Nothing, not one.
How did they decide to win it if they've not, if nobody actually lured any worms?
Well, a spokesman said they were all winners because they raised more than £200 for the Woodhall Spa Twinning Association. I don't know who Woodhall is twinned with.
I don't think it's twinned with anyone.
Some Russian psychiatric unit.
Why has she got a string on her fork? What's going on with
it? So she knows that that's her fork, like when you're at the airport. And you put a ribbon on, don't you?
At least when you go train spotting, there are trains.
That's the best thing. The train spotters are stood on the hill going, losers! Get a life!
Oh, dear. It's true.
Gigi and Cynthia, they're only jealous.
Were the first modern Olympics held? Still on Olympics.
Yes, 1896 was the first year, yeah. And I believe it was Athens.
No, it's not correct, I'm afraid.
No, no. Was it in Greece? Then?
No, it wasn't in Greece. I'm sorry about that. No,
was it London?
Hey, no, you're in the right country, though.
Damn.
If you've got the place, I'd be very surprised. Johnny might, if I were to say A. E. Houseman, you might get the place.
Salisbury.
Nope.
Shropshire.
Shropshire is the right answer. Much Wenlock, as in on Wenlock Edge.
Wenlock Edge.
The town of Much Wenlock from the year 1850 held Olympic Games. It's an extraordinary man called Dr. W.P. Brooks.
1896 was the first Olympic.
And so people suggest, but Baron Coubertin, who was the founder, supposedly, of the modern Olympic movement, and he wrote about W.P. Brooks. Much Wenlock is a town in Shropshire, a county on the borders of Wales. And if the Olympic Games that modern Greece has not yet been able to revive, he wrote this in 1890, Coubertin, still survive today, it is due not to a Greek, but to W.P. Brooks. It is he who inaugurated them 40 years ago. And it is he, now 82 years of age, still alert and vigorous, who continues to organise and inspire them. So Coubertin came to Wenlock Edge, and he, being a baron, having influence and political connections, was able to do what this little country parson was not able to do, which was to get the rest of the country, the rest of the world. But King George I of Greece, of the Hellenes, sent a silver medal to be a prize at the Wenlock Olympics. So for 46 years before the first Athens Olympiad, as it's counted, there were Olympic Games that are recognised by the very man who is known as the father of the Olympic movement.
Gosh.
So let's hear it from W.P. Brooks. But he died just a year before the Athens Olympics.
So 2012, Hackney.
Yeah. Could be, couldn't it?
Could be Hackney.
Could be.
Yeah. Nothing wrong with Hackney.
What a shithole. Kayaking down the Lee River.
I used to live in Hackney.
You can develop film in the Lee River, but you can't kayak.